Excuse me, we're going live. I may have to mute my mic because sometimes I echo when I'm in Second Life. Do you want to try it? Do you want to?
We can try it also.
Yeah, speak through Second Life and just to make sure that everything's okay.
Okay, now I switch on my microphone in Second Life. So, hello everybody, can you hear me?
Try again. I'm going to mute my mic.
Okay, it seems to work.
No, it's echoing. Wait a sec. It echoed a little bit. I don't know why. Maybe you have to lower the volume. Or I have to lower the volume. Okay, let's try again one more time.
Or should I switch off my microphone in Zoom? Because now I have opened both.
Okay, yeah, try that and see how that works. Okay, I don't know if you can hear me. Oh, you could hear me. Want to try again one more time? Were you speaking? I don't see. I don't think you're speaking, right? I don't see. All right, let me see. Hi, Nan.
So just people in Second Life were able to hear me.
Okay. All right. Dieter, do you want to try again one more time? I don't know why sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't.
How is it supposed to work with both, with Zoom and?
No, it's supposed to not echo. Wait a minute, so I'm muting you in Zoom. Please speak.
Yeah, but
through.
The funny thing, I don't hear any echo. That's a weird thing.
And you said that you turned on the computer sound?
Yep, right.
Okay, let me see.
Maybe you have both audio on in Second Life and Zoom, so you hear me twice.
Wait a minute, does anyone else hear an echo? If it's just me, then it's fine. Even though, I don't know. Okay, let me go into Second Life and disable. I can find Second Life. Okay. All right, let me try it. I've never done it this way. I've always had it open, but let me try it. Okay, can you try it again?
Yeah, of course. I can talk all the time. No.
It's perfect. Okay. So now you're speaking through Second Life and Zoom is open? Because that was perfect.
Okay. Sounds good.
All right. So we're okay. Let me just find out from Nan if it's okay. Great. Okay, perfect. All right, so it's perfect. All right, so when do you want to start? Because it's 3 minutes past.
Yeah, we can start. I don't think we will need the full hour. There will be time for discussion, but yeah, okay. If everybody is ready, then we can start immediately.
Are you going to introduce yourself?
Of course.
Great. All right. So hello, everybody, and welcome to VW MOOC 20. And today is Wednesday. So here is our speaker. We're looking forward to a discussion right after.
Okay, so welcome everybody. And the first, it's a real pleasure and honor to be a presenter here again, I think now for the fourth time already. And it's a really well-prepared event. So I really love to present here. And once again, I will present you the latest developments of our own virtual world platform and the lessons we learned from using it in a productive environment. Thanks to COVID-19, we were able to host a full master course lecture on our platform. And I will tell you about the things which went good, which went not so good, and also what we learned from this. I just, before we have a field trip next week, I've put some images in the presentation so you can see how the things are looking currently and what developments we did also regarding the graphics. So here is a quick agenda if things would rest rather quickly. Just let's wait if everybody can see the slide. I can't. Oh yeah, now it's coming. So first I will give you a quick introduction about myself, my platform, and also then the setup of the lecture, how everything was prepared and planned to do. Then, like I said, I will tell you about the things which went well, which went not so good, which conclusions we did draw, and also about the plans we have for the future, because the demand for remote learning is still increasing. Here in Germany, only schools started back with frontal and face-to-face lectures. The universities are not so, courageous. They probably will stick to remote schooling, at least for most of the time until early next year. So yeah, now everybody can see it, the agenda, introduction. So first, about myself, I'm a computer scientist, working in this field for almost 30 years now. I came into contact with virtual worlds early in the days of Second Life, so almost 15 years ago. And I quickly realized the potential for collaboration and also for teaching there. The technology was not perfect. And I always try to say things have to be simple in order to be used by a lot of people. And that brought me back in 2011 to start developing a platform from scratch on my own, which had a few major conditions. It had to run in a browser, so to have no installation and no visual updates for the user. So it should be easy, so no install and easy to use. So the advantage is running in the browser is you don't need any special viewer. It will not only run on specific devices, but currently we support all devices with a quite modern browser. So it runs on PCs, on Macs, on Chromebooks, which is very interesting for schools and universities. But also we support tablets and smartphones. We are currently revamping the user interface to be more mobile friendly. But in principle, you can join any meeting even on your smartphone, complete with voice support and everything. And to a certain degree, we also support virtual reality devices like the Oculus Quest and Go. Again, the access should be as simple as possible. So for accessing a meeting. You just have to click on a link somebody sends you. There is no installation, like I said. You don't need to register, so you can always join a meeting as a guest. We have text and voice chat, both in group and one-to-one. We support text-to-speech and speech-to-text features. So this is also working for different languages, which can be used either for people with disabilities, or also we've had a pilot project where we used it for a language learning. So we used the speech-to-text feature to say, okay, if I pronounce a text in a foreign language and the computer understands me, my pronunciation couldn't be that bad. We have also in-world build tools to create your own content. This means you can build from simple things up to a full region. And on the images, we will also see that we have regions which are completely built with the built-in tools. One more interesting thing is we also try to let you keep your intellectual property, and we support drag and drop for almost any file formats available which can be used in a virtual world. So it means you can simply drag a PDF or a 3D model from your desktop into the 3D world. It will be REST there. And so in this way, you can more or less keep your inventory on your own hard drive. So of course, if you drag something into the world, it will be uploaded to our servers. But we also have tools for supporting your inventory. But sometimes it's easier and also more, let's say, secure to have your content on your hard drive, and you can simply use it from there. This, also, best example is, it even works if you give a presentation. You can simply activate a single prim in our world and drag one slide after the other to this prim, and people will see what you are presenting. Okay, somebody's very creative here on the Zoom screen. Okay, and also which is important is, because it's browser-based, we can have things similar like HTML on a prim. And yeah, somebody really is very funny. Nelly, can you ban this person?
Yeah, I don't know why how they can do this, because the security doesn't allow them to do any of this. But yes, I'll remove. Let me just. Yeah, I've seen worse though.
Yeah. Yes. We all have.
Okay, so you know what I'm talking.
But it seems to be somebody which has the Zoom
a
link.
Phone. The what? Yeah. I don't know who to remove. I'll remove this one. Who else can I? Let me remove this one too. Okay, I removed this one. Let's see, who else should I? Okay, I think I removed everybody. Okay, so now I think you can go back to it. Let me just. You're the co-moderator. You know, you can also actually. Stop participants sharing. Okay, I don't know. I stopped. Did you want to start all over? Sorry.
Oh, no, it's okay.
Stop you as well. So, okay, so it's not Jarvis Fly, it's not Peter, it's not Nan, it's not. Okay, so this guy is not going to come back.
Yeah, I think it was somebody called Wilson or so.
Wilson? Because I'll tell you why. The annotation is off. So I don't know how this happened, but it's someone who knows what they're doing. Okay, so everybody's off. You can screen share. Yeah. But you know what? Let me make it one person screen share. Maybe. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, I'm sharing again. Okay, that's also something which we take care of in our platform. Security is a very important topic for us. Good thing is my company is specialized in IT security, so we can apply all these principles also to our platform, which means first all data transfer is encrypted. This means text chat, voice chat, everything is, let's say, secure. And you also, as a moderator, always have the possibility or the opportunity to ban people, not only by name or account, because with guests, it's difficult. They have no account. So you can also ban people based on their IP address. And so we were at the last point, the integration of HTML content. So we have something similar to an HTML on a prim. So this allows you to integrate many available web applications. So for example, we've integrated tools for screen sharing. We've integrated Moodle into our world. So it means you will see the content of your Moodle site simply like here on a panel or a virtual screen, and you can use it from there. Also over the last 2 years, we really improved the quality of the available graphics. So what you see during the presentations are all non-photoshopped screenshots. Those things are really looking in-world, like we see here on one example from our community region. So next slide. One major tool, especially for teaching, is what we call the Advanced Presenter. That's a type of element you can add to any regions, not only once, but many times. Yeah, some people are really funny. So this advanced presenter is more or less some working like a browser you can control during a presentation. It means you can mix any kind of media which is available on the web. So you can have static slides like JPEGs from a PowerPoint, like I'm presenting here, or images, but you can mix a presentation between static slides, and you can simply switch over to a video clip from YouTube or anything, and there is no visual gap. So it means you have one presentation and you can mix between the file things. You can have sound clips integrated. You can even have interactive web pages, which people can then open from your presentation and fill a questionnaire or a survey. So you have full control over every single slide, and it can be any kind of element which is available in a web page. The good thing is also you don't have to upload things. You can link your presentation directly to any web space like Dropbox or another file sharing service. So it means you can put your content there in your personal account and display and present from there. I will see you on the next slide. You see the heads-up display of the presenter. So you have controls for manual switching back and forth through the slides. You can also set a slideshow. So that means every couple of seconds, the presentation will switch to the next slide automatically. And you have the possibility to add slides on the fly to move them up and down in order. So it means you have full control what to present and where to. And we can see here, I think it's a bit small, but still we have static slides. And instead of a third slide, there will be a redirect to a YouTube video. So this is a real live lecture from a professor, which talked about a specific topic. And to make things more interesting, in between, he simply showed a YouTube video regarding this topic. And this will all happen on the same slideshow presenter. So people will not notice that we switched from a static slide to a YouTube video. For you, it's like a movie screen, and you will see either static images or moving pictures. Okay, started screen sharing again. Yeah, okay. So now what we are talking today. 18 months ago, we started with a pilot project where we provided group rooms for about 300 first semester students in economics and organizational behavior. We had 43 regions in total, 40 for the group work and three common regions. And this was a good starting point for us to learn how people will use the platform, but we also learned, especially for first semesters, things are difficult. They have to find their way around the university. They don't know their schedule yet. And then we also gave them a tool which is, or needs at least a little introduction. So the results were mixed. We had an acceptance rate of about 70%, but 30% of the people preferred to do their group work by WhatsApp groups or other means. So switch to 2020. Here we tried it with a smaller group, which were more advanced. So it was really a master course before their final exams. A group of 21 students, which were split about four regions. I will tell you the things later. And I will also tell you what went good, what went wrong, and our conclusions and plans for the future, because we already have requests to prolong this, let's say, project, and to have lectures there in the upcoming month. So this is a screenshot with more or less all people present in a virtual lecture hall. You can see some of the people found our Halloween costumes already. So we had a few astronauts floating around the room. And yep. So things are rising very slowly. I have no idea why. No. Ah, yeah. Okay. So the setup was, we had a huge lecture hall with seats for all students, so they could follow the lectures of the professors. We had three dynamic elements on the main wall. One really a video presenter where we uh, where we could project videos regarding the current topic. We had this this advanced presenter for presenting slides, and we had also one big element where the professor could share his screen and show different applications. So, for example, with screen sharing, you can put you can really stream a PowerPoint directly from your PC into the virtual world without uploading or preparing any slides. Another thing is we had best first to tell you about the breakout rooms. So for the group work, we had three breakout rooms where as student groups of 5 to 7 people could do their group work, their assignments. In there, they had two Google documents, one for their internal notes and one for writing down their results. And the interesting thing is, because everything is just referenced by URL, we had mirrors of this three result Google Docs in the main lecture hall at the back wall. So it means the professor could stay in the lecture hall and still see all three result boards filling slowly with content without leaving the room. So he could follow the progress of the three groups individually, and afterwards the students came back and and presented results. So this was a usual day. The lecture days were broken down in 3 to 4 segments, which were always working after the same model. First, the professor gave an introduction and talked about a topic for 20 to 30 minutes with slides and supporting video. Then he gave an assignment to the students. The students went to their individual breakout rooms, could discuss the assignments there, bring the results on the result document, and afterwards everybody came back to the lecture hall, and each group was then able to present their results inside the lecture hall to the professors and to the other groups. Just two more images, one from the lecture hall on the left, and the other is a typical breakout room with the two Google documents, the green one like a whiteboard or a blackboard in this case, where the students could make their notes, and the white one was used for the results. And here you could see, not perfectly, but next week I will bring you into these rooms, and you can see everything in action. So we had a video wall, the slide wall, and one for screen sharing. And these could be used by the professor to bring the content to the students. So one more screenshot from the lecture hall. This is the back wall where you can see all three result boards and also the big blue teleport buttons, which allows the students to enter their breakout rooms. Let's wait until everything is rest properly. And also we put some basic instruction posters here on the walls, so every student could read them and get immediately an overview how to handle things. So now the more interesting part. What went well? Also first, we had an almost 100% acceptance rate by all users. So some students had some remarks about it, but in principle, everybody really liked the experience because it was totally different from their previous Zoom sessions. The tools used worked, everything worked pretty well. One major advantage over Zoom meetings and other things is that in the virtual world, you have the feature called persistency. So it means if you change something in a room or you bring content into a room, it will stay there. Even if you come back a week later, things are like you left them a week before. So this is a major advantage because you can really build things and keep things like you want them to have. It's not not only a single session where things vanish afterwards. Here, everything is persistent and people can really use them to store information, exchange information, even offline. So I can drop a note for somebody which will join later and say, please here, read this article or so, and everything is working fine. The other thing which was well welcomed by the participants was the easy access. We simply had to provide a single link for all students. We were able to configure all tools in a way that students were able to join the lectures even as guests. So the students didn't have to register on the platform. They could simply come in as a guest. We only asked them to use their real names to identify people easier. But apart from this, they could do all the work they needed to do and still join the platform only as a guest only. So, the main point for us is that we really got positive feedback, and also the students and even also the professors brought new ideas how to improve things. I will talk about these later because some of them were really good, and we put this on our most wanted feature list, which we will we are currently working on, and these features will be available on the platform for all users in the near future. So what went, maybe wrong is the wrong word, but what didn't went so good? The funny thing is the students got comfortable within the virtual world more quickly than the lecturers. So the keyword here is digital enablement. So it's really important to not only teach people about the platform, but also about handling tools, different kind of tools, in an effective way, because that's what we noticed very early, thank God, so we could fix it quickly. But the professors always have the impression everything has to work just by clicking on a few buttons. But they didn't care which button they pressed at any moment. So sometimes you got the impression they didn't know what to do. And so that is one of the conclusions later. We need special training for the lecturers with a different focus. So it's not only on how to use the platform, but really how to use the platform for teaching, because that's a special use case. We underestimated this problem. Another thing was time management. So especially when using the breakout rooms, usually we said, please be back in 20 minutes. And after 20 minutes, nobody was back. So we had to teleport to the different group rooms and tell people now it would be time, or to send them an instant message. This also led to a feature we will add soon, and I will tell you about you later. We had individual technical issues with voice and performance. So one student was using a laptop out of a museum. So it was a laptop from 2010. And we didn't expect this, but we managed to make it work by trying out different browsers. And we learned that Firefox is better for old hardware and Chrome or Edge is better for modern hardware. So these are things we have to live with. Also, there are sometimes problems with voice, not based on technology, but based on local configurations of PCs. So sometimes it's not so difficult, not so easy in Windows to assign the proper audio device. Even I, Selby, can confirm it. Even on my PC, sometimes it happens that when Windows finds two audio devices on a PC, it uses the microphone from one device and the speakers of the other device. This can lead to trouble, and when it's troubling a person like me, then it's more troubling for a casual user. So what we are working on is first to create a list of devices we already tried and which we can recommend for using, or if it's possible to have a, let's say, a really simple setup and use the built-in hardware of your laptop. So if your laptop is equipped with speakers and microphone and you use it, usually you will have the least problems. And one thing which you could easily fix is the students liked to stay in the virtual world during breaks, and they wanted to have a kind of break room for students only, not for the lecturers, but where they could meet independent of their group assignments and just talk or just stay there and spend some time. So we simply imported a region for this purpose. So this was the problem we could fix within minutes. So as a conclusion, also, we still think that web-based virtual worlds are a great solution for remote teaching and interactive group works because they are very easy to use, very easy to access. And you are not limited to a special hardware or operating system, because there are always discussions about the future, if the future is virtual reality, augmented reality. Of course, there will be applications using these technologies, but when you talk to people in their early 20s, I think the main future device will be a mobile device. So if it's a smartphone, a phablet, or a tablet, but it will be something mobile and control will be by touch. So this is something we are trying to consider, and with our approach using a browser as a viewer, this will support the maximum number of different devices. The students themselves were very quickly enabled to use the platform. We offered them 2 1-hour sessions, and usually after the first sessions, the students already were proficient in using the platform. So when we introduced them to the integrated Google Docs, within a couple of minutes, we had the first animated GIFs with clips from The Simpsons on the screen. So they were getting familiar with everything very quickly. And the interesting thing is, you could notice the students which were very affine with playing computer games, and they also they navigated through the virtual world within minutes. And these were really helpful by supporting their peers. So there were people which never played a computer game before, and the others were really able to help them very quickly and to show them how to navigate a room, how to sit down, how to use the interactive objects. So for students, it's really simple. Like I told you before, with the lecturers, it's a different thing. They really do require more training to not only navigate the virtual space, but also to use the tools properly. So they need to learn how to set up a slideshow, how to bring in their content in the required formats. And yeah, so we've already set up some paper and some wiki pages, which will especially teach lecturers how to set up things for teaching. And finally, the project really gave us some great ideas for the future, how to improve things and also to create some new tools, which I will tell you about in a moment. So, another screenshot from one of the common rooms, so where people can spend time just sitting there and talk. So a typical break room. Okay, I have to be patient again until the slide will rest. Very slowly, but okay. I can't see it yet, just the outlines, but hopefully in a second or two. Trying to speed. Yeah, now. Okay, so what are our plans for the future? We are currently negotiating new collaborations with more universities here in Germany. So the winter semester will start in the second half of October. And we will prepare special setups for these purposes. I'm sure next year I will be able to tell you more about these projects and how they went and what conclusions we did draw from them. We've identified a set of new tools which we think are very will be very useful to be used in teaching environments. What is a timer object? So it means you will have will be able to use a kind of countdown timer in the breakout rooms, though that the students will get a visual and also an audio signal when time's up and it's time to come back to the lecture hall. Then something wanted by the lecturers is a virtual laser pointer so that you can really highlight text or points on a slide for everybody, so which they are used in real life. So this will be something we will emulate, and so you can highlight parts of a slide. And also, we are currently improving our documentation. We've set up a so-called wiki, which can be maintained more easily and also more in a more timely fashion than a PDF or a document. So it means when we change things in the user interface or if we add a feature, we can simply update the online documentation. The wiki is reachable from the user interface in world. So it means you can simply open the documentation in a separate browser tab and see how things are supposed to work. Another thing we are currently preparing is a list of recommended applications. So it means when we talk about application, it means other web pages or web applications which can be integrated into an HTML control. So it means like on a slideshow presenter, you could have your institution's Moodle system. So your Moodle would be directly integrated into the 3D world. And this works, at least from our experience, with many more applications. So we found applications for creating mind maps, real whiteboards where people can not only put text, but also draw images in real time and many people at the same time. So this is really helpful. And the thing is, of course, you can try out very simple every application on your own, but we will try to give you a list of tools based in categories like word processing, whiteboard, surveys. And so it means if you are using an application from this list, you will know we already tested it and it worked properly. So for me, it took about half a day to test several applications which allow screen sharing over the web. And finally, I found one which was, I was able to integrate and test it within 2 minutes. And I will show you next week on the field trip how easy it is to simply bring your screen on a prim in world. So it's working and everybody can use it. So it's really helpful to use screen sharing combined with the virtual world advantages. And we are also designing a training program for the lecturers. So we will have a real training plan for them. And thanks to the input of Selby, we will give them some incentive so they can earn badges for participating in these trainings, and they can also track their progress. So, final picture. Yeah, that's also one of our break rooms, or in this case, it's my personal office. And you can also see if you have a little bit better graphics card, so you can even switch on real-time lighting and shadowing. So it means things will even look more realistic. And this is really a region which was built just using the InWorld tools. And finally, these are our contact information for me and also for Steve Levin. He's here as Saul Biederman, and he's providing hosting for us in the US. So we can if you're interested, we can quickly provide you with a sandbox region for a couple of months free of charge. So you can try out things and simply use them to test if it's working for you. And this is very easy for us to set up and to provide. So if there are questions, feel free to ask, and I'm gladly answer everything as much as possible.
Yes, Dieter, thank you. Thank you so much. I have a question about interest. I want to get into, you know, how it's going, but are people ready for this? People who are in virtual worlds and are so used to Second Life and, you know, having everything on their computer rather than web-based, are they having a hard time accepting another platform such as what you're suggesting, which is so simple and so easy, so much easier actually?
Maybe that's an interesting, stuck. Yeah, you brought up a very interesting point. So far, 80% of the people using our platform never had contact with a virtual world before because they thought it's too complex, it's too difficult.
Mm-hmm, exactly. So I'm wondering about the ones that are, you know, in Second Life or virtual world, are they having a hard time, you know, trying to find something simpler? Is that difficult for them, do you think?
The most of the people find it easy to use. Of course, if you are used to building things or create things, then mm-hmm. it's difficult because it's different. So our tools are more optimized for browser usage. They are in some parts not so sophisticated. In some other parts, they are more complex. You have more control over things like in Second Life. So it's difficult to compare. The point is, it really depends on the kind of users. Really, let's say the casual user usually has no problems because most things are not identical but similar. So just moving around, using post balls or clicking on objects, that's the same in every virtual world. But what people really like is the easy way to join a meeting without previous experience. Because, for example, every 2 weeks, I'm giving a so-called developer, I'm organizing a so-called developer talk. And sometimes people which have seen one of our YouTube videos simply drop by because they found the proper link. And the thing is, when people arrive, they are muted, but they can hear what we are talking about. And from this point, we can guide them through the first simple steps. So it means we can tell them, please click on the microphone icon and you can speak with us. Use your cursor keys or WASD for moving around. So it's very simple to give people a crash course in using the platform. Of course, if you will do or want to do more sophisticated things, you need experience. And here, yes, we are different from the other platforms. And if you are used to Second Life for many years, there might be some, not problems, but issues in the beginning. But our goal was not to compete with Second Life or OpenSim. Our goal was simply to provide an entry-level virtual world for people which had no contact with virtual worlds before.
Right. What about schools? Are schools finding it? I mean, young learners, higher education, are they interested, especially now with, you know, the lockdown and the world going virtual? Yeah. Is there more interest?
With higher education, yes. With small pupils, the most difficult thing is especially with remote schooling. So I think small children are too easily distracted by everything. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think for them it's too difficult to concentrate on a school lesson in a virtual world. But I think so from maybe fifth, sixth, seventh grade onwards, it's much easier. And currently we are mainly having adults as users, and for them, we really get the feedback that it's a great way compared to Zoom or Skype meetings.
So, Dieter, would you say that most adults who use the platform use it for an alternative to Zoom, maybe as a way to for live communication, virtual communication?
Right. So it's really, it's a tool, we always say, for communicating and collaboration. We also have a couple of, not only for, also some groups which are not using it for teaching, but really for collaboration. I'm not sure if everybody is familiar with the so-called agile software development. The keyword here is Scrum, which is an agile method of developing software. And this usually consists of maintaining a so-called Scrum board. It's like a pin wall where you put post-its with the tasks involved developing your software. And the tasks are divided into columns from specified in development, ready for testing, and ready for publication. And these tools can be integrated into the virtual worlds. And one feature of this agile method is a so-called daily meeting, where each and every developer talks about the things he has done the day before. And these meetings are perfectly done in a virtual world, because you have all the tools you need available, and you have the communications methods available. So people can talk, exchange information, and document everything in a persistent way on a virtual wall.
So is it like a planner where you...
It's like a planner, but especially for developing complex software systems. It's a so-called Scrum method, or an alternative is a so-called Kanban board.
That's interesting.
And for I think, as especially what people like compared to Zoom is, with Zoom you always feel like you're being observed by everybody else.
You do? What do you mean?
So personally, I don't, but if students are watched by their camera, sometimes they say, I always feel a little bit stupid.
Oh, really? I know a lot of people don't want to open their cameras. I mean, my students, you know, at the beginning they do, and then they decide that they want, their eyes are going to go somewhere else, and you can tell from their eyes where they're good, that they're, you know, somewhere else. That's the reason, not because they're shy. No, I mean, you can't compare Zoom, because Zoom, you just sit at home. You're not really manipulating anything or doing anything. It's pretty static.
Right. And here you have the full possibilities of interactions. You can, with a physics engine, you can show physics experiments in real time. You have, like I said, you can mix any media and bring in a video clip just by dragging and dropping it into the virtual world. You have no limits. And it's much more interactive.
Yeah, I just, so let's say I want to, if I compare it to, say, Zoom, if I want students to present, how would the presentation, student presentation, or, you know, be carried out and compared to Zoom, say, with a virtual web-based
In principle, it would work the same. Also, for a student presentation, the simplest thing is screen sharing, and you just make the student the current presenter, and he can directly present from his PC to everybody else.
And on the virtual system, would it have any other element to it that would make it, I don't know, more interactive?
Let's say it depends on the content. The other thing is, of course, I can give a student the same rights and privileges like a lecturer, and then he can also use the advanced presenter. So he can mix static with interactive content like any other presentation.
Okay, my last question, sorry for asking so many.
No, the more questions, the better.
You mentioned Moodle, and you know that that's where I live most of the time. So how does it work? How would you add it to Moodle?
Or yeah, the point is Moodle is just another web-based application. So when we can bring any HTML content to a prim, so it means like a slideshow presenter, you have an element which hosts your Moodle instance. And when people click on it, they can interactively use your Moodle instance directly from the virtual world without leaving the screen.
So it's actually just a link. You share the link and then
it's a link. And the thing, of course, is we redirect the output to one of our elements. But in principle, the people will work on your Moodle instance, but this instance will be integrated visually into the virtual world.
So it's not an API or anything like that?
No, because this would have been either too complicated, and it's not necessary.
That's necessary, right? Because it's web-based. Yeah. It's just a link.
And with this link-based integration, you can integrate many really valuable tools simply by using the URL of the tool, and it will be displayed inside the 3D world.
But it's not embedded. It wouldn't be embedded on a Moodle page, would it?
This way, it's also possible. Also, we allow our content to be embedded in other web pages. We demonstrated it, I think, 1 or 2 years ago of Selby's blog pages. So you could enter the virtual world through that blog page. So it's simply an iframe, and this iframe will contain the virtual world.
Because what happens, for example, with a YouTube link or a Vimeo link on a Moodle page is that it's embedded, comes out as a live video, it's open. So I was thinking maybe the link would have the embed in it, and you don't have to embed through an iframe or anything like that.
No, that's not so easy because of the WebGL used. The iframe is a single line of HTML.
Yeah, I know. I just don't I don't allow it on the Moodle for various reasons.
Yeah, of course, because you have no control what happens in that iframe. It's because it's just it's a different browser instance, technically. Mm-hmm.
Okay, are there any other questions or comments? We're going to have a demonstration, right?
Next Wednesday, I will post on Google Docs the link where we will meet, and then I will show you everything I talked about today in action. And you can see all these elements you have available for using for teaching. I will demonstrate how this advanced presenter will work, how screen sharing is integrated, and also how to use the breakout rooms and to see results in real time, almost literally everywhere.
Is there a place to try it out? Like last year or the year before, I think you shared a lounge or somewhere, I think with Selby, if I'm not mistaken, or you can go and try things out. And I think I did at some point and it didn't always work. Is that still available, a sandbox where we can go and try things out? Or that you're going to do that next week?
We can do that next week, but the thing is, the problem was in the beginning, we gave a free region to every user. The problem was we ended up with literally dozens of empty regions which were never used. So the things now, you can have a sandbox region on request. We can create it. It takes me 5 seconds to create an empty region, which you can then use and try out things.
Okay, so we'll have to wait till next week and see the changes.
I think compared to last year, we will have again a lot of changes, some very obvious, some not so. What we really did improve was the voice communication. Currently with the student project, we had more than 20 people connected in voice without any issues.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so you're very, very welcome.
Are there any other questions? I'm looking at the chat to see if there are any questions.
I also scan the text chat.
In Second Life, if there are any questions there. Do you see any questions? I don't.
No, just
comments, right?
Comments from Selby and.
All right. So thank you. I think we've reached the hour plus. Thank you. Thank you for joining us in the fourth year. I had no idea the time. It just seems to fly.
Yeah.
This is our seventh year, and you've been doing it for four. So thank you.
But it's always a pleasure to come back.
That's great. I'm glad because we're enjoying this as well. So thank you. Thank you very much. And
my pleasure.
Let's see if there are any questions. I'm muting everybody on Zoom to see if anyone wants to say anything. Sorry. Anyone in Zoom want to ask? I think, Jaroslav is clapping. Okay, I don't see any questions. All right, so thank you, everyone. We'll see you tomorrow. Dieter, you're also invited to join us if you have time.
If I have time, I will join because most of the things are very, very interesting.
That's good. All right. Yes, we're learning together, as Van Stevens says. All right, thank you. Thank you so much. I'm going to stop.